Oh, good day, everyone, everywhere, and special greetings to all those seated in heavenly places in Jesus our Messiah. The name of this broadcast is Cross the Border, and I'm Nicholas, and this is our Prophecy Reality Edition. Today, I wanted to talk a little bit about, a chapter from my book, which is really a deciding factor in where you stand on eschatology. And it's based upon your interpretation of Daniel's 70 weeks prophecy. And that's from Daniel chapter 9, verses 24 through 27. Those four verses make up the entirety of the 70 weeks prophecy. Yes, four little verses. So where you stand in these verses and how you understand them determines what you believe about Bible prophecy. So it's very important. If you accept the literal interpretation of the 70 weeks, that they are actually 70 contiguous weeks, as proposed, as laid out in the text of those first four verses itself, then you would be a historicist and you would realize that the 70 weeks are completely fulfilled. However, if you're a futurist and you believe that somehow there's a gap or an interval between the 69th and the 70th week, well, the burden is on you to show us how you have an authority to depart from the literal reading of the text. I wrote in my book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled, and everyone should read the book. You can get a free copy, and I've given several thousand copies away free. If you go to my website, you can get a free e-copy. It'll come in a PDF form. Absolutely free. All you have to do is go to my website, crosstheborder.org, click on the free ebook tab there, and follow the simple instructions. Yes, you have to subscribe to my blog, and you have to let your friends know that the free ebook is available by word of mouth, by posting it on your social media or whatever. And by doing that, you're not endorsing the book, because you can put a note: this book is free, you should check it out and see what you think about it. I'm not making any judgments yet, but here's a link. That's a share, okay? And you share it on your Facebook or whatever media you have. And you can do that anytime, not just when you get the book for free. And then I expect a follow-up. And for several thousand free copies that I've given away free, I have got only 9 reviews now on Amazon, okay? So I think I should have a few more reviews. So if you're a follower of this broadcast, you've read the book and you haven't wrote a review yet, please, you know, go and write a review. I need hundreds of reviews. So you're not doing me any favors if you take the book for free and you read it and then you don't review it, okay, or not even share it or whatever. Okay, so please, please do that. If you go to the free ebook tab, the link is there to Amazon, to where the reviews are for my book on Amazon, and you can simply write a review. Say, I got a free copy from the author, I'm writing a review. And be honest about the review. If you don't agree with something in the book, please, you know, cite the page of the book or the chapter that you're talking about, and then bring up the biblical references to support your variance or your disagreement with my conclusions. And I would really appreciate that. So positive or negative reviews are welcome. And they will help me to perhaps change my mind or perhaps explain myself better in subsequent revisions of the book or on this broadcast. So anyway, I want to thank everyone for doing that, you know, right now or immediately after the broadcast, saving that review page in a tab and coming back to it later when you have a few minutes to write a review. Okay, so thank you for that in advance for all of you that do that. It's one way you can support this broadcast. If you can't support it financially, well, and speaking of supporting it financially, not many people out here doing this. Not many people out here supporting the Protestant historicist view of prophecy. Not many people out here running programs like Inquisition Update and other broadcasts that we have, Greg Anthony's Journal. And so, you know, First Amendment Radio really needs your support. Okay? Honestly, we barely have enough support to even support myself, let alone have a producer here and several men working on the property here for the ministry or whatever. We can't afford to pay. I can't even afford to pay myself. How can I afford to pay someone else? So we need your support. So go to firstmemberradio.com. Press the support button. If you're in a chat room, press the support button. If you're listening live right now, it's a Wednesday morning, about 9:15 a.m. Pacific time, 15 minutes after noon on the East Coast. So come over to First Amendment Radio, click on the chat room button, and join us there. Okay. Today we're going to be talking about, as I said, Daniel's 70 weeks prophecy and that chapter in my book. So let's jump into it. I have it here somewhere. Daniel's, and this chapter I've entitled the Daniel 70 Weeks Challenge. There are two different interpretations of the Daniel 70 Weeks prophecy. One is the literal or historical view, which holds that the 70 weeks are contiguous and therefore completely fulfilled at the first century. The more popular is the futurist view of the left behind fiction fame, which holds that the 70 weeks are contiguous except for the last or the 70th week, which is preceded by an interval or gap of an undetermined amount of time. I used to believe in the futurist gap view without really understanding it because I just accepted what I was taught by men who surely understood the Bible better than any layman, which is what I was. I was just a layman, a carpenter, builder, going to church on Sunday and being taught the futurist view from the pulpit, doing the hopping and skipping and jumping through the Bible to build, make a cohesive presentation of the view to me. And so I hopped and I skipped and I jumped through the Bible at the behest of my teachers, my pastors, and in the pulpit as I sat there in the pew or the audience, and I accepted it. Certainly they knew what they were talking about, and certainly they had no intention of misleading me. And I do believe that. They had no intention of misleading me. But that doesn't mean that they were not misled. Well, about 1995-96, God called me out of the construction work I was doing and into radio ministry. And it didn't take me long to jump into God's Word and decide this is what I want to do. Because I was doing a kind of a talk show host, interviewing people like so many other talk show people out there, doing a current events thing. And just felt like, well, I was not accomplishing anything. Sometimes I felt like I was prostituting myself to sell the books of other people just so I could have a show on the radio. And it just didn't feel right. So I felt like I need to just open God's Word and jump into it. So it became a serious matter for me if I was going to start going through the Bible. And there were men that I admired as a carpenter. I would listen to the radio on the job when I was able to control the radio. And of course, I would listen to Bible teaching and Christian music. Whereas if I was on a job site with where there were a lot of other men and someone else had control of the radio, it was always the idolatry of romance pop music. So I came to admire some of the expository Bible teachers. because it got me into God's Word and decided that now here I am on radio through really no effort of my own, just kind of happened, and the opportunity reared its head, and I said, okay, I'm for that. And so I went for it and found myself teaching and going through the Bible on the air to emulate some of the other Bible teachers on the air that I really held up in high esteem. And so I wanted to teach people what I believed and what I believed to be true and from the Bible. And when I looked for the gap, the 70th week of Daniel, or the 7-year tribulation period, I had a very difficult time finding it in the scripture. And so it was very important for me to teach the truth and to teach the truth from God's Word. But that was a problem. I just couldn't find the 7-year tribulation period explicitly stated in the scripture anywhere. And I didn't want to be a false teacher. So if the gap or the interval were there, I certainly needed to find it, but I simply could not find that gap or interval. And we have the warning from the scripture. I took it very seriously. In Revelation 22:18, it says, "For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of this prophecy and of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book." And another place it says that if anyone subtract from the things written in the book, that his name shall be subtracted from the book of life. Well, this is very serious business when it comes to teaching God's Word. And I took the warnings there very seriously. And I thought, well, I have to make sure that this is what God's Word is saying. And if I'm going to teach it, it has to come from God's Word absolutely. Because I don't want the plagues added to me, and I don't want my name erased from the book of life. Otherwise, why am I walking? I might as well go back to being a carpenter and listen to the idolatry of romance pop music. Okay, so I started to investigate the idea that the 70 weeks are contiguous, and to my surprise, I had to admit that the literal view was absolutely viable, and to this day I've not been able to exclude it by the scripture alone. Yes, and to this day, and here we are 20 years later, and I have not been able to exclude it, but I have been able to exclude the other view by scripture. So I felt I still needed to look at the best futurist teaching I could find, and I certainly don't want to be unpopular and wrong at the same time. So to unravel this mystery, I went straight to Chuck Missler, and I believe I played my video, Show Me the Gap, Chuck, here last week or the week before. So I hope you all enjoyed that. And if you go to my website, crosstheborder.org, you can just put in Show Me the Gap in the search box there, or go to YouTube, put Show Me the Gap, Chuck, and you'll find it somewhere there, but make sure it's the right one. Show Me the Gap, Chuck, by Prophecy Reality, or me, Nicholas Arthur, and you'll have the video. So if you haven't seen that, go to my website, crosstheborder.org, and make sure you look that up. And he admits that you would think by the plain reading of the text. That's where I get literal interpretation from, the plain reading of the text. But he says, and I quote him, and you can see it because I put his own mouth speaking the words in the video, we would naturally think that the 70 weeks are contiguous, one right after the other. And they are, he says, but then digresses, except for an interval between the 69th and the 70th weeks. That's not conjecture, he says, it's expressed in the text, unquote. Well, all I can say is that Chuck Missler is sincerely deluded or a liar, because I looked very carefully, and I've been looking at that text for 20 years, and I can absolutely say with every certainty that you could possibly muster, no matter how you look at the text of those four verses. There is no interval, okay, expressed in the text whatsoever. It is only conjecture that produces an interval or gap between the 69th and the 70th week. There is nothing in the text of the four verses of the 70 weeks prophecy. There is nothing in the book of Daniel, nor in the entire Bible, that expresses a gap between the 69th and 70th week. So do check out that my challenge to Chuck Missler, the Show Me the Gap posting on my website, if you haven't seen that already. And spread it around, please. So I continue my chapter here. So I reread the text, but could find no gap or interval expressed in any of these verses. Nowhere in any of his prophecy teachings, that's Chuck Missler's prophecy teachings, could I find an explanation for this irreconcilable statement. Nor has any other so-called prophecy teacher been able to show me the gap. And I'm going to put on the screen here the entire text of the 70 weeks prophecy. So here it is, all four verses. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon the holy city, to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, to anoint the most holy. Therefore know and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto Messiah the Prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the wall, even in troublous times. And after the 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood. And unto the end of the war desolations are determined. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. And in the midst of the week he shall cause the sacrifice and oblation to cease. And for the overspreading of abominations he shall make it desolate, even until the consummation, and that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. Now, I have several questions that have come up in the chat room about this four-verse prophecy, which I posted before the show. And perhaps I should look back here. And the questions are basically this. Did all of the things mentioned in the four verses necessarily have to happen within the 70 weeks? Or were some of the things to happen in the 70 weeks and some of the things to happen after the 70 weeks? Because if you believe that everything in the four verses was to happen within the 70 weeks, well, that's problematic. Okay? Because then the 70 weeks would have to end at 70 AD. But if you, with a careful reading of the text, we see that there's no confusion whatsoever about what is to happen within the 70 weeks itself and what may happen after the 70 weeks. So let's look at this again. Let's look at this again here quickly. And you'll see that it says 70 weeks are determined upon the people of the holy city to finish. Okay, so it lists these six things here. To finish the transgression, make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and the prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. Okay, all of these things are to happen within the 70 weeks and must happen before the 70 weeks ends. Okay, however, now we see that He says, know therefore and understand from the going forth of the commandment to restore and rebuild Jerusalem unto Messiah and the prince shall be 7 weeks, 62 weeks. So he gives us a starting point the commandment to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. Okay, that's the starting point for the 79 weeks, and specifically the first 69, because he says the 7 weeks plus 62 weeks to equal 69 total, and he says things that will happen, the wall will be built again, and the street, and even in troublous times, and that happened. And after the 62 weeks, which happens after the first 7 weeks, so after the 69 weeks, shall Messiah be cut off. Now, it doesn't say immediately at the end of the 69 weeks, or the Messiah shall be cut off before the 70th week. It only says after. Now, so we know that after, that the Messiah won't be cut off before the 69 weeks is complete, but only after. So anything after, so if it happened 10 years after the 69th week, it would still be after. But that he was cut off, it says, but not for himself. Okay, so we know that Jesus was cut off 3.5 years after he appeared on the scene as the Messiah. Before, 3.5 years after he was 30 years old and was baptized. Okay. So we know that happened after, but it happened during the 70th week. So because it only happened 3.5 years after the 69th week was complete. So it happened within. But it also says here, and the people, the prince that shall come, shall destroy the city and sanctuary, and the end shall come, and the end thereof shall be with a flood. Now that happened in 70 AD. That happened quite a while after. But see, it only says after. So anything that happens after the 69th week ends can happen during the 70th week or any time after that, because it is only after. Otherwise, if God wanted us to know that this happened during the 70th week or within the 70th week, he would not have used the word after. He would have said, and during the 70 weeks, the Messiah shall be cut off, and the people. He would not have said, and after the 62 weeks. He would have somehow let us know that this would also happen within the 70 weeks, but the language here, the prophecy is very specific and exacting, because God knew that one, the Messiah would be cut off during the 70th week, but after the 69th, but also the end that came with a flood would also be after, but not necessarily within. So the word after was appropriate for both instances. And we'll continue this when we get back from the break. You're listening to Cross the Border, our Prophecy Reality Edition. We'll be right back.
Visit crosstheborder.org, C-R-O-S-S, crosstheborder.org, to get your print, EPUB, or PDF version of the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. That's crosstheborder.org.
I know you all want answers, and believe me, so do I, and I'll do my best to get them.
Despite Nicolas Cage's promise to do his best to get Left Behind Rapture answers for us, don't hold your breath. Not everyone believes Left Behind is true prophecy. Some may even regard as conspiratorial the mainstream re-release of the Left Behind movie, with actor Nicolas Cage portraying the main character, as an attempt to further reinforce in the minds of all this perception of false prophecy, in order to condition the masses for the play about to begin. If you want true Bible prophecy answers, get the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. The author exposes the Latin rapture origin, the seven-year tribulation deception, true Bible revelation of Daniel's 70 weeks, the abomination of desolation, the restrainer, America in the revelation, the image of the beast, and the mark of the beast, and the truth about God's chosen people, and so much more. about Bible prophecy. This book will shatter the left behind paradigm of future events. Get the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. Visit crosstheborder.org, C-R-O-S-S, crosstheborder.org, to get your print, EPUB, or PDF version of the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. That's crosstheborder.org.
Welcome back. You're listening to Cross the Border, our Prophecy Reality Edition. And we're continuing here to talk about the Daniel 70th week challenge, Daniel 70 weeks challenge. And I have an illustration. You can also find this illustration in my book, which may make it easier to understand what we're talking about when we are discussing Daniel 70 weeks, and we're talking about the time frames and what comes after, when it says after the 70 weeks. Okay, so I've charted it out here to try to make it simple. We start, of course, with our decree to rebuild. And of course, there's the 7 weeks. The city, the street, and the wall are built again, even during troublous times. It happened, okay? And following that, there's a section called the 70 weeks, totaling 69 weeks here. Okay? Unto Messiah the Prince. That's what it says. Jesus is 30 years old. He qualifies now for to perform as a high priest, to perform a sacrifice, to minister the people as a high priest. The qualification being met by his age, he shows up at the Jordan River and is baptized by John the Baptist. And there are several signs there that, yes, he is the Messiah. And so people start to follow him, and he goes about preaching the gospel of the kingdom. 3.5 years later, or in the midst of the 70th week, he is crucified. Okay? He is crucified. And so we see that he is in the midst of, okay, what is it here? And after the 72 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. Okay, so there he is. He's cut off on the cross, and it says not for himself. He was cut off for the people, he was cut off for you, and he was cut off for me and anyone who will take advantage of the work he did on the cross. Okay, 3.5 years later, in the midst of the week, he was cut off. 3.5 years later, the 70 weeks ends. However, everything from this point that happened, this was after 3.5 years, was after the 69 weeks. And something else that happened 43.5 years later was also after the 72 weeks. And that's why I have from here, I have an arrow going out into the future after the 72 weeks. We are living after the 72 weeks. So that's all after means. It does not mean within. So this here, the Roman desolation, did not have to happen within or at the very end, because it only says that it will happen after the 69 weeks. So there it is graphed out for you. And I challenge anyone, as I have written here, anyone to show me anything in this illustration that is inconsistent with the 4 verses which comprise the complete text of the 70 weeks prophecy. If you cannot exclude this view by the text, then it must be seriously considered. The prophecy is completely fulfilled as it unfolded in history. This is one more example of the historical, grammatical, or historicist interpretation demonstrated in the scripture itself. That's the evidence. This interpretation is totally without conjecture. Only what is explicit or expressed in the text is allowed, something that cannot be claimed for the renderings popularized by the voluminous fictional books and feature-length movie series such as Left Behind. I have a standing challenge to anyone to show me the gap between the 69th and the 70th week explicitly stated anywhere in the scripture. And that challenge stands until this very day, but I'm going to tell you, since 2011 when I posted the challenge, show me the gap, Chuck, and the challenge is there to anyone at the end. I put my email address at the end of the video, asking anyone, but you know, no one, not one single person in 5 years has stood up to the challenge. And it's easy to understand why. Because there is nothing that they can challenge it with. The gap or interval is simply not in the scripture. Okay? So just how important is this question? It is the cornerstone of the entire futurist scheme of eschatology, the Achilles heel, if you will. Certainly, one can conjecture 1,000 supporting verses for every fallacy, but that makes them no less false. Tens of thousands of Christians make decisions based upon the futurist left behind rapture scheme of things, because it puts things where they should be concerned with today off into a future which is primarily a fantasy. At the same time, confining imminent and future dangers to a false 70th week period of time in the nether future, which even when that time comes, they will be pre or mid-tribulation raptured to safety. And of course, we're talking about the 7-year tribulation deception. Okay. And I have enough time here. I'm going to play a video, and this is from the Greatest Prophecy DVD, one of the chapters in it, and it covers this section of my book. Okay, because I did the video, I wrote the video, produced it first, and so I developed the rest of this section in my book, and I'll show that to you here. Daniel's 70th week as history, to give you a illustration of how Daniel's 70 weeks have been completely fulfilled in history from the scripture itself. I mean, where else would we turn? Let me put this up here and we'll play the video. The prophetic puzzle.
He first findeth his own brother Simon, and saith unto him, We have found the Messias, which is being interpreted the Christ. Philip findeth Nathanael, and saith unto him, We have found him of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write.
Today people are interested in prophecy. 2,000 years ago, there were people like us also interested in prophecy. Now imagine living in a time 483 years into Daniel's 70 weeks prophecy. You know the history of your people, how the temple and the city were restored exactly as Daniel the prophet foretold. You recognize that it is the end of the 69th week and know the Messiah is about to step onto the scene. Like Andrew and Philip, you would be actively seeking him, and once you found him, would it ever enter your mind that the 70th week would not follow the 69th? The gap theory would not be developed nor perfected for some 1500 to 1800 years. Andrew, Simon, Philip, and Nathanael lived through what they would have no doubt was the 70th week of Daniel. Let's see how their version of Daniel's 70th week, or the last week of years determined for Israel, plays out. Daniel prays for his people and for the temple at Daniel 9:16.
O Lord, according to all thy righteousness, I beseech thee, let thine anger and thy fury be turned away from thy city Jerusalem, thy holy mountain. Because for our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers, Jerusalem and thy people are become a reproach to all that are about us. Now therefore, our God, hear the prayer of thy servant, and his supplications, and cause thy face to shine upon thy sanctuary that is desolate for the Lord's sake.
Suddenly the angel Gabriel appears to him.
O Daniel, I am now come forth to give thee skill and understanding. At the beginning of thy supplications the commandment came forth, and I am come to show thee, for thou art greatly beloved. Therefore understand the matter and consider the vision.
Note that Daniel is told to understand the matter. Continue.
70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression, and to make an end of sins, and to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the vision and prophecy, and to anoint the Most Holy.
Let's investigate the 6 purposes of the 70 weeks. 1. To finish the transgression. The ultimate transgression of the Hebrew people is expressed by Peter at Acts 3:14.
But ye denied the Holy One and the Just, and desired a murderer to be granted unto you, and killed the Prince of Life, whom God hath raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses.
And then Stephen, immediately before being martyred, proclaims,
Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost, as your fathers did, so do ye. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted, and they have slain them which showed before of the coming of the Just One, of whom ye have been now the betrayers and murderers.
Thus we see that the thy people of Daniel 9:24 included the very ones who were responsible for the death of their Messiah. The national transgression is complete. 2. To make an end of sins. This does not mean that men will never sin again, as some of the futurist camp would argue, for the scripture confirms that men will even sin in the millennium after the great tribulation of the futurist interpretation of a juxtaposed 70th week, so this argument is against their own unscriptural view as well. Our New Testament writers confirm the true meaning.
But now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself.
Then again,
For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust.
So he did make an end of sin. 3. To make reconciliation for iniquity. We find nothing so clear as the following.
For if when we were enemies we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement.
A second witness.
Wherefore in all things it behoved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people.
4. To bring in everlasting righteousness.
But my righteousness shall be for ever, and my salvation from generation to generation.
Isaiah 51:8. And Peter confirms of the Messiah,
who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness.
Is there any doubt that he ushered in everlasting righteousness? 5. To seal up the vision and prophecy.
For the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy.
Revelation 19:10. Jesus was the great prophet
of whom Moses and the prophets foretold. Jesus, his disciples, and Paul all prophesied. Since the days of these, no new writings of the saints are considered the prophecy of God and added to the Bible. It is sealed up in the works of Christ and the men he chose to complete the Holy Writ. 6. To anoint the Most Holy. Stephen calls Jesus
the Holy One and the Just.
Acts 3:14. And Peter testifies
how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him.
In summary, all six of these purposes were fulfilled during the 7-year period following the appearance of the Messiah. The 70th week of Daniel did immediately follow the 69th. Should we be surprised? No. There is nothing in the text to move the final week off to some undetermined future fulfillment. In the words of the Messiah at John 19:30, it is finished.
Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the Prince, shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the wall even in troublous times.
It is almost universally agreed that the time period of weeks in the passage literally translated would be sevens, and has nothing to do with the common use of the word today. So we have the building of the temple and the city taking place in the first 7 sevens, 49 years, which is a fact of history not in dispute. The following 62 sevens, 434 years, are known as the silent years, when Israel did not have a prophet, also not in dispute. Adding these two time periods together, we have a 483-year countdown unto Messiah the Prince, and the beginning of the final and 70th week, during which he did confirm the covenant with many.
And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself, and the people of the Prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined.
After the 69th week shall Messiah be cut off. There is no other time period given in the prophecy of the 70 weeks for this to take place. That he was cut off, but not for himself, in the middle of the 7-year period immediately following the 69th week, places it smack in the middle of the 70th week. Verse 27.
And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week, and in the midst of the week he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease, and for the overspreading of abominations he shall make it desolate, even until the consummation, and that determined shall be poured upon the desolate.
Who is the he in verse 27? Is he the messenger of the covenant, foretold of the prophet?
And the Lord whom ye seek shall suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant whom ye delight in. Behold, he shall come, saith the Lord of hosts.
Or is he the fictional Antichrist character of the Left Behind series? The answer is in the text itself. Immediately antecedent, we have the people of the Prince that shall come, but they do not qualify as a he. The Prince does not qualify, as the term is used only to describe the people, so is not antecedent, because it does not describe a specific person. It is the Messiah who is the only he that qualifies. To confirm the covenant means that it must already exist. He was the messenger of the covenant, the Messiah, and in the midst of the week he shall cause the sacrifice and oblation to cease.
Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom.
He, the Messiah, did it. He caused the sacrifice and oblation to cease by the sacrifice of himself.
And every priest standeth daily, ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God.
Yes, the priests may have replaced the torn veil and attempted to carry on as before, but God thereby declared an end to the priest-temple sacrifice system. The overspreading of abominations, complete with the national rejection of God's Messiah, and any attempt to continue with the blood of bulls and goats instead. The desolation of the city and the temple were determined. 40 years, and the consummation would come like a flood, with the people of the prince to come, the Roman army. Conclusion. Therefore it is well established that the prophecy is completely fulfilled within the 490 years allotted to it. Daniel's 70 weeks are history. There is no gap. Period. These prophetic mysteries are not so much to be understood beforehand as to be acknowledged after they come to pass, which verify the word of God and bring good men to the obedience of his truth for his glory. Peace be with you all. Okay, there you have it. Any questions? We see that it is possible and more likely that the 70 weeks are completely fulfilled. And were completely fulfilled in history, that the 70th week does follow the 69th week. And without some authorization from the Word of God to juxtapose it, put it off in the future, to insert a gap or interval, well, I have to accept the literal view. See, they always want the literal view. They always claim to have the literal view. And I guess it helps to claim to have a literal view, whether you have it or not. But if you say it long enough and enough times, that maybe people believe that, well, that must be the literal view because they keep saying literal view. Well, I've showed you right here that an interval or gap between the 69th and 70th week is no way a literal view. It doesn't matter how you cut it. You know, it's cutting it straight. That's what we want to do with God's Word. We want to rightly divide God's Word. And we realize that by doing that, there is no gap whatsoever. And we talked about the He in the text, that He shall cause the sacrifice and oblation to cease. And they say that, well, the Messiah, they don't want that to be the Messiah. But so they make it the second person prince, from the phrase, the people of the prince that shall come, rather than the first person Messiah of the previous two verses. It's quite a reach. That's what you call scriptural gymnastics. You get someone, get yourself an English scholar, okay? And for this, it doesn't matter what version you use, whether you use the Authorized King James Version or one of the New Per versions, okay? To determine who the He is, what the antecedent or who the antecedent is to the He of the text. It is only the Messiah. It can only be the Messiah. It has to be a first person antecedent in the text. It can't be a second person, the second person prince, because the people, the prince, are first person, but they don't qualify as a He. Neither does the prince be in the second person of the statement, identifying the people that will destroy the temple and the city. Does not qualify. If you get yourself an English scholar who knows nothing about the Bible
and ask him, who's the he in the text? You'll only get one answer, because there is only one answer. It is the first person Messiah of the previous two verses is the only one who qualifies as the he in the text. Okay, well, we're going to go into a little break here, have some news, and we'll be back in a few minutes. You're listening to Prophecy Reality. Go not anywhere. The book of Revelation says, the spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus Christ. This is at the very heart of FirstAmendmentRadio.com. In that spirit, we have created the Prophecy Reality News app for all of your mobile devices, streaming First Amendment Radio 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Available for your Apple, Android device, and smartphone absolutely free. Get the Prophecy Reality News app installed today, so you can listen to First Amendment Radio wherever you are. The Prophecy Reality News app. Get it now.
The program you are listening to is 100% sponsored by you, the listener, on this First Amendment Rights Media channel. You will notice that there are few commercials on this radio network. There's a good reason for that. Corporate advertising dollars come with strings that limit program content. So without your help, these programs cannot continue on internet or our several affiliates. If you benefit by the educational law programs, we ask you to give. If you are admonished or nurtured by the Bible and ministry programs, we ask you to give. If some voice a cause that you are passionate about, we ask you to give. If you believe in any of these, we ask you to support them as you would a missionary on a continual basis, as if giving a tithe for missionary radio. These programs are not commercially viable and must be supported by those faithful to the cause of truth. Look for the button to sponsor your favorite programs at our listen and schedule pages on the internet. Then, when you subscribe, we will send you the last quarterly MP3 CD of that program immediately, and continue to do so with each new quarter. We will also give you unlimited archive access to all of our programs. We're asking you to give much less than a tithe, so that you may also send support directly to a particular program host, cause, and anywhere else the Spirit may lead you. Do all to the glory of our God and Creator, for His holy nation, the only kingdom that will last forever. Thank you for listening.
Welcome back, everyone. You're listening to Cross the Border. That's our Prophecy Reality Edition. And today we're talking about Daniel's 70th week. We covered the 70 weeks challenge. We looked at the historicity of the 70 weeks completed, how the scripture can be interpreted using the historical grammatical interpretation. The historical biblical interpretation, the method taught by the scripture itself on how to interpret prophecy, we see that it is absolutely and completely fulfilled in history, the entire 70 weeks, contiguously from their beginning at the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. Looking at the chat room here, I see Bass Tracker. And I guess he's a fisherman, so if you track any bass there, make sure you send some my way there, Bass Tracker. He says, okay, where did I read that? Okay, it must have looked, must have went off. Uh-oh. Oh, he says, just because Titus and the Roman army destroyed the temple and Jerusalem in 70 AD does not mean that God blamed them for the destruction. And that's a very good point, and I think everyone should understand that, that even the text clarifies that for itself and for us, where it says, for the overspreading of abominations, he shall make it desolate. So clearly upon the Hebrew people who were abominating against their God, as they had once before, it brought about the destruction, the desolation of the temple. So the desolations were determined for the overspreading of abominations. That means the complete abomination of the nation. It had become complete to where God would execute judgment upon the people, upon the city, and destroy the temple, as he did once already at about 586 BC when Nebuchadnezzar came in, Babylon came in as the sword of God and executed judgment upon Israel. This was being repeated again, only God using the Roman sword, to execute judgment upon the nation Israel for their rejection, the national rejection of the Messiah. And of course, warned by Daniel the prophet, warned by Jesus to flee before that desolation came, those that decided to go against the national religion, the national leaders, and accept the Messiah, they fled and they followed the instructions of the Messiah. They followed the prophecy of Daniel and they left the land before the desolation came. Okay. Another thing I wanted to take a look at, which can be very confusing for a lot of people out there, because so many people have abandoned the King James Version. And, you know, I was tempted to do this, you know, back before I started teaching the Bible. I was tempted to do this and accepted, well, the New King James Version, which wasn't really too much of a deviation from the authorized King James Version. It just, you know, and it made it sound real good, and you clear a few things up and get rid of some of the archaic wording of the text. And, you know, that's always a good thing to understand, you know, what's archaic and how it was used in the past and how we don't use phrases like that anymore. It's very important to our understanding of God's Word to understand what the words meant when the book was being written, just like law, you know. To understand a law or the Constitution of America or any historical document, well, you have to understand what the words meant when the law or the book or whatever it was being written, to understand what was actually being written. So it's a good thing to know. And but now we have all these, well, I call them perversions. They come out of the Jesuit thinking, and many people are beguiled by these. And like I said, I was, you know, amenable to accepting some of these newer versions, clarified versions, or they proclaim that we have an older text now, but now we find out that the older text is not really an older text, that it's been altered, and the claims by the people who made those claims are not what they should be. And I have an excellent video that I didn't do myself, but let me find that for you. Bear with me for a second while I go there. I'm going to go to the firstamendmentradio.com YouTube page. That's it. So you're there. See that YouTube button on firstamendmentradio.com or the chat page at the bottom? If you click that, it'll open up to the front page of firstamendmentradio.com YouTube page. And you scroll down a little bit. Okay, so I'll even put this on the screen as I do it so you don't have to see my face. Okay, so here I am at the firstamendmentradio.com YouTube page. And I scroll down a little bit where it says saved playlists and something funny about Sinaiticus. Okay, and this goes into the older texts, which they say are better. Well, older is not necessarily better, and he proves that to you. And this is from David Daniels at Tick Tracks. Very good. You should subscribe to his page, and he continually comes out with excellent short video teachings on things. So check that out if you want to understand the problem with the newer versions and why you need to stick with the authorized King James Version, the best, the very best English translation. Yeah, written at an eighth grade level, so it's not a problem if you persist. The these and the thous and the wherefores and therefores will all make sense to you. Because remember, it is written at an eighth grade level. All of the newer versions are written at 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th grade, college grade level. So actually they are harder to understand. But I'm going to demonstrate something to you between the new English versions and the authorized King James Version using the same text that we're using today. And I believe this is not a translation, but it is an interpretation. And to my mind, the way I think, I don't want an interpretation when I read the Bible. I want a translation. I want as close to a word-for-word translation of the original text that I can get. Not the oldest text, not a corrupted text, not the Vaticanus or the Sinaiticus, okay, which are corrupted. And like I said, you go there and you'll find those. I can get my producer to put a link to that in the chat room for those that are listening. I'll include a link when I post this video to that video I was talking about, so you can check into the supposed older translations, which lead to the perversions of the text, and you can see how this has been done by our enemy who wants to pervert God's word. But I'm going to demonstrate it to you using the text that we have been in for the entirety of this broadcast. Let me put it on the screen here. And here we have it, the complete text of Daniel's 70 weeks in the authorized King James Version. And for my example, I'm going to use the English Standard Version there in pink, as you see it. And we have, maybe I could parallel these. Look at that. We can parallel them. On the right-hand side, this one here. Maybe I'm not doing this right. Okay, it's not telling me which side is which here, but let me... King James Version on the left, ESV on the right. So let's get down here to our text. King James Version on the left, ESV on the right. So, and you can see that the problem begins here. Number one, let's go to the he in the text. Okay, now, and he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. Now this is plain. We're looking for the antecedent to he. Okay? And it says he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. And so this means that the covenant must already exist. And we know that Jesus verified by other prophets, is specifically speaking the book of Malachi, that he was the messenger of the covenant. So he did confirm the covenant. So it's verified in another place with another prophecy that Jesus, the Messiah, would come as the messenger of the covenant. And here we have Daniel says, and he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. Okay, well, this is 1 week of the 70 weeks prophecies. Okay, and so we have to determine who is the he and who is the proper antecedent for the he in the text. Okay, so on this side, on the King James Version side, we're looking for a first person antecedent who qualifies as the he in the text. Okay, so we have here the previous verse, and after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. Definitely qualifies as a first person antecedent in the text. Okay, but not for himself and the people of the prince that shall come. Well, they're antecedent, you know. The people of the prince are antecedent, but they're not a first person antecedent. So that would be confusing for God to do that to us, to have a first person antecedent to qualify for the, but and then have a, the people don't qualify as a first person antecedent because they are not a he. They are a they, okay? And the prince, from the phrase, people of the prince is not a first person antecedent, but a second person antecedent. So not really qualifying. Let's go back another verse. Okay, we have Messiah the Prince. Okay, qualifying. I don't see any. So we have from the previous two verses a first person antecedent being the prince, the only qualifying antecedent for the he in the text. Okay? That's English. That's proper grammar. Okay? There is no way, by no matter how you cut it, that the second person prince from the people of the prince that shall come phrase can qualify as a first person antecedent. You have to jump to a... Okay, so, and see, the King James Version translators don't have a clue what this verse is about. They're not trying to interpret the text for us. They're doing the best word-for-word translation from the Textus Receptus that they can. The oldest Greek Hebrew and Aramaic manuscripts that they have. That's what we call the Textus Receptus, the ones that are compared with other ones and that show us that this is the best translations. This is what, if you read the foreword or the translator's foreword to the authorized King James Version, you'll find out that's what they said they would set about to do. And they had to come up with a system for doing it, a very exhaustive system for doing it and checking it and rechecking it. And that was their intent, to do a word-for-word translation. And there is no way they were trying to interpret this because they didn't have a clue what it meant. And you can see they were just trying to give us the best verse-for-verse translation. However, now we jump over here to the ESV, which is like so many of the other ones. And another thing in the text, and we'll talk about that in a minute, but let's talk about the he first. Okay, here we are with the ESV, and that's the New American Standard, and so many are just like it, from the Sinaiticus and the Vaticanus, which have older, complete manuscripts, which they're, you know, broadcasting. This is the reason this is better, because... But as you, if you check out our friend there from Daniel, David Daniels from Chick Tracks, and go through it with him. He's going to show you incontrovertibly that this is absolutely wrong. This should not be. We can't rely on these texts. Okay, so and I'm not even sure, but you'll see that this is an interpretation here on this side, whereas this is a translation, and we don't want an interpretation. We want a translation. So anyway, let's look at it. And he shall make a strong covenant with many for 1 week. So you see a change there. He's not going to confirm something that already exists. He's going to make something new. He shall make a strong covenant. So you see a definite bias there. You want to get rid of the covenant that already exists. Okay? We want a new covenant, so we have to interpret this differently than the word-for-word translation. We have to get rid of this archaic translation because we're interpreting it. We don't want this to be the Messiah. So the Messiah confirmed the covenant, and according to Malachi, he was the messenger of the covenant. But here, this doesn't make any sense by any means, by any other prophet in the scriptures, but it fits perfectly if you have an interpretation you're trying to support. And so who is the he? So we still have the problem of who is the he? Who is the proper antecedent? Who is the proper first person antecedent? So how do they deal with this problem here? So we go back and we see that after 62 weeks, an anointed one, no longer a Messiah, no longer a first person antecedent, just an anointed one, some anointed one, not a specific first person anymore. So we got rid of the first person antecedent Messiah. And we got an anointed one who qualifies as equally as the prince, who is also not a first person. Okay? So how did they get away with this? Okay, well, let's go back one more verse. And we have over here, unto Messiah the Prince, absolute first person antecedent for the he. You know, twice, two times in two verses, we have a first person antecedent he that is definitely the Messiah in this text here, which is not an interpretation, but a translation. Over here, this is an interpretation. It's more than a translation, but it is an interpretation. So what do they do here? And they go, going out of the word, going forth of the commandment, going out of the word to restore and rebuild Jerusalem to the coming of an anointed one, still ubiquitous, not specific, not a first person antecedent, not a qualifier as the he in the text. Because we do not want this to be the Messiah. This has to be a future unknown person. And the only way we can destroy the idea that this is the Messiah is to remove the Messiah from these verses. And that is exactly what they have done. But still, we don't have a first person antecedent in either of these verses any longer. So we have to go back further. Okay? 70 weeks are determined? Nope. You know what? Now there is no first person antecedent in the four verse text to qualify as the he. And that's a problem. So God must be trying to confuse us here. We still have the same problem. You know? Well, we have no problem over here in the translation, but in the interpretation where we're trying to get rid of the idea that this could be the Messiah and make it out to be some future unknown Antichrist so that people don't look at the Pope of the Reformation, the accusation of the Reformer saying that the papacy is the seat of the Antichrist, but to conform to Ribera's futurist Antichrist scheme of things, this is only a Jesuit counter-reformation interpretation of the text. Because one, God is trying to confuse us because we don't have a first-person antecedent in the entire text. So it's still problematic, even for the futurists. Even with their new, supposedly newer, complete texts, older complete texts from which they claim to get their translation. So still we have a problem here. Okay, and now what do? They also, to make sure this can't be the Messiah, they have to change this. Okay, over here on the translation side, the authorized King James Version side, it says, he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. Malachi called him the Messiah, absolutely the Messiah. Read it for yourself. Chapter 3 of Malachi. That it says that he calls him the Messiah, the messenger of the covenant. He shall come suddenly. Okay, it says in Messiah, and Jesus did come. The Messiah did come suddenly. He did confirm he was the messenger of the covenant. So completely conforming to other prophecies and other prophets. So we have a second witness, at least, if not more, that Jesus was the he of this interpretation, the only qualifying he on the translation side. Excuse my messing up there. Okay. And it says, and in the midst of the week, he again shall cause the sacrifice and oblation to cease. Okay, so what happens here? Okay, and he shall put an end to the sacrifice and offering. And for half of the week, he shall put an end to the sacrifice and offering. Ooh, it's not in the midst of the week. It says for half of the week, he shall put an end. And of course, that's the last half, because in the midst of the week of the futurist books and fiction account, is the Antichrist is going to step up and say, well, you can no longer do that. Okay? So they're trying to turn this to the changes so you can say, well, there's no way if I say the he of verse 27 is the Messiah, and you read that, and you go, well, you can't, that can't be the Messiah, because if you read their version, well, that can't be the Messiah. Okay? And here, especially, this nails it here, this change here. For the overspreading of the abominations, he shall make it desolate. Okay? God judged Israel for the overspreading of abomination. Okay? But they change it. On the wing of abominations shall come one who makes desolate. So that would have the he coming on the wings of abomination instead of bringing judgment for the overspreading of the abominations. Here, as we said before, for the overspreading of abominations, he shall make it desolate, places the blame on Israel for bringing judgment upon the nation, the city, and the temple, as God did in the time of Nebuchadnezzar when the first temple was destroyed for the overspreading of abominations. He made it desolate, using the Babylonian army as his sword in judgment upon his people, because judgment begins at the house of the Lord. And then we know that God used Babylon to judge all of the nations around Israel afterwards, and then finally judged Babylon using the Medes of the Persians, wielding the heathen as his sword in judgment. So it happened again. For the overspreading of abominations, God wielding the Roman sword executed judgment upon the city, the nation, and the temple once again. And we'll continue talking about this when we get back from this break. You're listening to Cross the Border. This is our Prophecy Reality Edition. Don't go anywhere. And go to my website, crosstheborder.org. Make sure you subscribe there and take advantage of that free ebook tab. Please do that and write a review. We'll be back in a few minutes.
Visit crosstheborder.org. CROSS, crosstheborder.org, to get your print, EPUB, or PDF version of the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. That's crosstheborder.org.
I know you all want answers, and believe me, so do I, and I'll do my best to get them.
Despite Nicolas Cage's promise to do his best to get Left Behind rapture answers for us, don't hold your breath. Not everyone believes Left Behind is true prophecy. Some may even regard as conspiratorial the mainstream re-release of the Left Behind movie, with actor Nicolas Cage portraying the main character, as an attempt to further reinforce in the minds of all this perception of false prophecy, in order to condition the masses for the play about to begin. If you want true Bible prophecy answers, get the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. The author exposes the Latin rapture origin, the seven-year tribulation deception, true Bible revelation of Daniel's 70 weeks, the abomination of desolation, the restrainer, America in the revelation, the image of the beast, and the mark of the beast, and the truth about God's chosen people, and so much more about Bible prophecy. This book will shatter the Left Behind paradigm of future events. Get the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. Visit crosstheborder.org, CROSS, crosstheborder.org, to get your print, EPUB, or PDF version of the book, The Rapture Will Be Canceled. That's crosstheborder.org.
Welcome back. You're listening to Cross the Border. That's our Prophecy Reality Edition. like you to go to my website. Please subscribe there. Press on some of those share buttons when you find a good article and something that that blesses you and you think might bless somebody else. Help get the word out there. Press on that free ebook tab and make sure you get the book. And those of you who have read my book or have enjoyed my broadcast for these many years, write a review. You can write a review about me if you haven't read the book, but please read the book anyway. And go there. There's a link there in the free ebook tab to write a review on Amazon. You can also write one on that page. Write it there on my page in the comment section first, and then copy it to your Amazon link there. Okay. When we left, we were talking about Daniel's 70th week. We're comparing the newer interpretive corrupted text Bibles to the translation of the Authorized King James Version. And we find some very funny things. We find that the problem still exists as to a first person antecedent for the he of verse 27. Even with their perversion, with their several machinations in the text there to make it so that it cannot be the Messiah. So you have to settle, even though it's still not proper, you have to settle to make that the Antichrist that's going to come in the future. Okay? So they've set about to do this and still messing it up quite a bit. So when you read the perversions, the new interpretive translations from the corrupted text, it's problematic. So we know there's something wrong with their translation because there's a problem that still exists in the text. Whereas if you read the Authorized King James Version, there's no problem. There's a proper first person antecedent for the verse 27, he, in the text. And we show you how they further muddy the waters here by changing the text so that where on this side, where it says, for the overspreading of abominations, he shall make it desolate, this can be the Messiah. This can be the King of Kings executing judgment upon Israel, which is his place. For the overspreading of abominations. But over here they change it to, on the wings of abominations shall come one who makes desolate. Well, that definitely cannot be the Messiah. So we have to exclude the Messiah. The he can't be the Messiah. So if I just tell someone the he has to be, the he can only be the Messiah, and I'm looking at the Authorized, but they open up their Bible and they go, there's no way that he can be the Messiah. And they're right. The he in this text cannot be the Messiah because the Messiah is not going to come on the wing of abomination. As a matter of fact, what is the wing of an abomination? You know, the overspreading of abominations, I understand. And that means, you know, that means that where we say the overspreading of abominations, if we translate the text from the Hebrew or Aramaic and we say overspreading of abominations, well, it makes sense. We know exactly what that means. There's no concern about the translation. It means that like America today, if I say, man, abomination has overspread America. The overspreading of abominations in America is so complete today. Yes, the entire world. Well, you understand what I mean. But who ever heard of someone coming on the wing of abominations? Right? It's kind of something that's not even used in the scripture. You know, that it doesn't make any sense, the translation. But if you want it to be, if you're interpreting this, in, or you want people to interpret, let's say they're not interpreting it as the Antichrist. The people that are doing this, you have to understand, are called Jesuits. They are in charge of the Counter-Reformation. One of their main objects is to counter the Reformation. and especially Counter-Reformation eschatology, which 500 years ago, about the same time that the Jesuit order was established for the purpose of countering the Reformation, they came up with this idea through one of their Jesuit priests, Ribera, of the future Antichrist, a character to supplant the idea, to wipe out the idea that the papacy was the seat of the Antichrist. And you can see that that is the total purpose of the newer translations. There is no other purpose for changing the translation here the way they have. And they can say, well, you know, that it's a viable translation because overspreading in the text, yes, the translation can be perverted from the original texts of the scripture, because the idea of overspreading is, well, you'd have to get into Hebrew and understanding Hebrew to really search it out, but I invite you to do that. But you can see the intent of the newer translations to wipe out the fact completely that there is no way here, if you read this verse in the text of the newer translations, there's no way that he could be the Messiah, because the Messiah would never come, would never be identified as one coming on the wings of abomination, on the wing of abominations to make it desolate, until the decreed end is poured out upon the desolator. Okay, and so there's another change there. And here on this side we have, and that determined shall be poured out upon the desolate, meaning national Israel in this side. Over on this side, well, who the desolation is being poured out upon, okay, the wing abomination shall come, one who makes desolate, until the decreed end is poured out upon the desolator. So this changes this to an end time scenario where this is more specific and can be determined to have happened within the actual contiguous 70 weeks of history. Okay. So, but here's your clue here, right here, is the he. Here in this interpretation, there is no qualifying first person he for the text. That's problematic. That means that somehow God messed up, okay? Because there's no first person he. So now it becomes ubiquitous. Anyone here can be the he, you know? So why can't, it's a pick and choose thing, because when you read down here, well, this cannot be the Messiah, but over here it can be no one else but the Messiah acting as the King of Kings, executing judgment, as is the place of the King of Kings. And the first person, we have a first person here, he in the previous two verses making the first person only qualifying first person as the antecedent for the he being the Messiah. Unquestionable. So there it is. Decide for yourself and look into the issue for yourself. Okay, let's see. We got any other questions or anything in the chat room? No, no questions. Everybody's convinced, right? Am I doing my job here? Wow, where'd everybody go? Well, okay. All right. Yes. King James Version only. Well, there is a King James Version only movement out there that I don't agree with. So you got to be careful. What I will say about the King James Version, the authorized King James Version, is the best English translation out there. Okay? It's the one you should use if you're going to use any English translation. It is the best. There's a movement out there that they say the King James only movement, but they want to exclude even the Textus Receptus, the oldest compared transcripts of from which the King James Version was translated. They don't even want you to look at that. They want to exclude that. So there's an extreme there called the King James Only movement. I don't go with that one either. Okay? But I do believe that the Authorized King James Version is the best translation that we have. And these other ones, and you know, for the most part, a lot of these, most of these English, newer English versions, they are true and good translations through 90% of the text. But anywhere that, there's a lot of places, you know, that's that 10% that gets you, where they're trying to uphold the idea of the papal authority, or they're trying to destroy the Reformation idea that the papacy is the seat of the Antichrist. We see that clearly demonstrated in those versions, and I hope I've done an adequate job of showing you that clearly in the text of the 70 weeks prophecy. And like I said, go to David Daniels there at Chick Tracks, and you'll find a link there on the FirstAmendmentRadio.com homepage too. I believe that I have him there in featured channels. Is he there in my feed? Yes, there it is. So if you go to our FirstAmendmentRadio.com homepage, you'll see him there in the featured channel. So make sure you subscribe to his blog, and I hope you'll enjoy that. But definitely check out the link there to save playlists and something funny about Sinaiticus. And there's a whole bunch of videos there, every one valuable and worth watching. So definitely give him a thumbs up and subscribe to his vlog there, his YouTube page. And Chick Tracks are great. I always have a bunch around. I'd like to have more so that I can give them out to the children and stuff. So kind of get a lot of these young Catholic children out here, an alternative to what they're being indoctrinated as. So I live in a predominantly, as far as Catholic area here, because of the amount of people that are being imported from south of the border. Yes, sir, primarily Catholics. Okay, well, what else can we talk about? I guess we can just talk about anything now. Anyone wants to call in, and now would be a good time. And that phone number being, if you're listening live, would be 559-797-8537. So give me a call, 559-797-8537. And you'll find that number in the right-hand upper corner of the chat room page, the left-hand upper corner of the FirstAmendmentRadio.com homepage, and your calls are welcome. I'll put you right on the air, and we got about 10 minutes left, so hurry up and call in if you're not going to. If not, I guess I'll just have to find something else to talk about. what can we talk about? How did you like that? How'd you like that? What was that thing? That debate? Yeah, not really a debate. I think Hillary was adequately hyped up on drugs, probably some kind of pep pills there, keeping her awake, because it actually looked like she was going to nod out on it and getting bored on a few occasions there, especially at the beginning. But once she got her mojo working, you know, guy whispering in her ear, talk. Yeah, so, you know, she was well trained and got her thing off, but, you know, of course, who cares? I mean, one of her main jabs was, you know, that Trump doesn't want to show his tax returns. Well, I ain't going to show nobody no tax returns either. You know, and you know what? If I were Trump, I would have said, just because I become president doesn't mean I have to give up my right to privacy. And you can believe that as president, I will stand for your right to privacy, too. Now, those emails, that's a different story. And he was right to respond, well, I'll show my tax returns when Hillary comes up with all those emails she deleted. So who won the debate? I don't think there's any winners out here. The American people are never going to win. And if I had my druthers, well, I would hope that that Trump gets in there, and perhaps we can have a Cyrus for the Christian church and the Christian people in America, whereas Israel had a Cyrus in the past who was a heathen king, but, you know, was a favor to show God's people favor, and that's exactly what happened. So there you go. I hope that Trump can be a Cyrus to God's people. And because I've seen him intimate that he would be, because he's one of the few so-called politicians, if you could really call him that, that has stood up for the persecuted Christians in the Mideast. So anyway, I'm hoping. So let's see, anybody in the chat room got anything to say about that? As WW gives us a Crayola crayon with which to color. Very clever there, WW. Go to crosstheborder.org and make sure you subscribe there. Click on that free ebook tab and enjoy the read there. And there are links in the text itself because it's a PDF, and so you can follow up and watch the What Year Is It video too, and also Show Me the Gap Chuck and other videos there. Make sure you check those out. And also available when you qualify to receive the free e-copy of What Year Is It? Boy, see, I should have ended this broadcast 5 minutes ago. Yeah. Will be made available to you also, the Hori Apocalyptica abridgment there, The Last Prophecy, so you can get both of those, and do make sure that you leave a review on both of those. Anyway, I'm terribly failing at closing out this program right now. Maybe I should do a little Hillary interpretation for you. Time to get out of here. All right. Thank you all for showing up, and may the Almighty bless you as you continue in His kingdom every day until you go to see Him or until He returns, whichever comes first.